We're back. Welcome back to VFX and Chill, the show where we do all the VFX and chill and things. I don't even feel like remembering what we do on the show. Hashi, how are you, sir? I'm Seth.
I'm doing well, Seth. I am reporting live from the Canada.
From Canada! You did it!
For the first time. So I have crossed a border. Very exciting.
I could not be happier for you. This has been about 30 years it's taken you to get across the border?
32 years.
Incredible.
In the making. But we're here, and I'm very excited because today we have some really awesome guests back on the show.
We do.
Returning guests.
You know what? I'm going to go to Michael first. Michael, you seem to know things. Can you give us some facts about our guests before we get to them?
Well, our guests have worked on many, many big-name Hollywood things and big-name car things.
That's right. Please welcome Doug and John from Perception. That's all the info you needed. Hey, guys.
Hello.
Howdy.
That intro was spectacular.
Thank you, by the way. Yeah, I'm going to need that and just play it in my living room.
Absolutely.
They've worked on stuff and things.
They do work on stuff and things.
They work on movie things and car things and just basically cool things. Like, if you're a child who's into cool things, you'll be into the things they make. Or if you're an adult who's into cool things, you'll be into the things they make.
Yeah,
I was like, let's limit it to children. We don't do adult things.
No, yeah, this is a show for children, and we're only talking about your child. So we do have to start by first off saying thank you for coming back on the show. We had a blast last time you were here. Michael will assuredly put the link to the last time you guys were on here in the chat. Last time you came on, we started by talking about, not the most recent thing you've done, but something that I think had been recently unembargoed or something was WandaVision. Currently, this one we're excited to get to talk to you about today is the intro, which Hashi so gracefully and brilliantly ripped off at the beginning of our show here. You guys did the titles for Hawkeye.
We did.
They're awesome.
Yeah. It's more than just titles. It's like you've got main title sequence, like main on ends, and they I've not seen all, but it looks like they evolve over the course of the show.
Yeah, so the main titles, episode one, are opening titles. Those are 100% different from the end titles of the rest of the series. And then every episode, we kind of evolve it a little bit here and there, adding a new shot, removing a shot, kind of playing up plot points or characters that get revealed. We'll kind of throw them into the sequence. But yeah, so it's basically two totally unique title sequences for this thing, which was fun.
That's so good. I mean, it's a lot of work.
That's really cool. That's something that they would never be able to do, you know, back in the day when they had to make these titles before the shows got even shot. And it was like, you didn't have the ability to turn around this kind of stuff like we do now.
Yeah.
Computers, technology.
Yeah, right.
So it's basically the modern version of like playing like stills from the show in like a Charles in Charge or something with
you know, we pitch that every single time and they never choose that option.
I miss the still frames with the like three funny moments from the show. You remember this wacky moment. Mm-hmm. All right, so Seth has pulled up this incredible title sequence over in the corner here.
So you said you did just two marvelous different ones, or like did it change with each episode? I'm sorry, I was paying attention to some computer thing when you guys were talking about that.
So our process kind of went in a bunch of different directions as we were starting off on making the title sequence for Hawkeye. It started initially with just the thought that like we'll do a traditional sequence that is tuned into the general themes of the story and is kind of a mood piece. But early on in the process, the team at Marvel Studios, particularly Trin Tran and Brad Winderbaum, were talking to us about ways that we could use the title sequence to fill in little bits of backstory. And so there were actually a few different approaches that we were exploring and experimenting with in terms of just like the format in general. And would it be at the beginning of the episode? Would it be at the end of the episode? Would it be a consistent thing? Would it be an evolving thing? Would it be super custom to each sequence or each episode or whatnot? And ultimately, we landed on this idea that particularly the first episode, which introduces Haley Steinfeld's character, Kate Bishop, It would be great to have a little extra backstory around her. And so we ended up kind of plotting out and you know, figuring out what would be a story that we could tell that fills in this gap. There, the first episode has this great cold open with her as a young child. And then the first shot of the episode post-title sequence, she's a college student. And so we worked really closely with the team at Marvel to figure out ways that we could kind of fill in that story and build that out. And, you know, that's something that for us, just that part of the creative process is like, it's a really big honor for us to be invited into that. And, you know, they have obviously an amazing team and incredible writers who were floating out different sort of like bullet points for what that narrative could be. But we also had an opportunity to make a bunch of suggestions of our own. And we're also approaching it from the perspective of like, we know the style of this is going to be very, very flat, very graphic, very bold. And so trying to figure out, well, what kind of like narrative beats can we convey in like shadow puppets, right? Or in like, you know, this very limited sort of fidelity that we have to work with. So it was really fun collaborating with them on that process and kind of filling in those gaps in the story.
What I love about this is literally no matter what frame I land on, it's dynamic. It's like incredibly dynamic visually. It also communicates immediately like what you were going for in the narrative of like of kind of filling in between the cold open and the first scene of the show. It's just like literally just stopping on frames, you accomplished exactly your goals. It's really impressive.
It is spectacular. And also I love that every time we talk to Perception, it's like, so the guys from Marvel called us again and asked us to work on a Marvel, huge Marvel property again. And so
they're always calling.
Yeah. It's not lost on us how, you know, how fortunate we are to consistently work on these things. It's I think I go into this first and foremost, just being a fan of this stuff. And like, to me, the most exciting part is like, I get to learn about Hawkeye before other people learn about Hawkeye. Cool. You know? And then it's like, oh, and now we have to work on Hawkeye. Okay. But like step one, I was always like, I get to watch this thing or see it or learn about it. It is very exciting. You know,
well, the question from the chat is who did the illustrations for this title sequence here that we're looking at right now?
So we had, just in general, we had a really awesome team working on this project throughout. And so I got to give some shout outs to the key people that helped us through the whole way. So Greg Herman is an awesome creative that we've been collaborating with for years and years. And he helped us with the initial designs and concepts that just sort of like got this whole approach approved in the first place, and then helped with leading the team through a lot of the process. Steve Savale, super talented creative and leader, was also guiding our team through this whole process. We had a whole bunch of different people who were varying degrees of like illustrator and motion graphics artist who were pitching in throughout the whole process. A lot of the illustrations that you see come straight from the hands of Ed Tranquino. Zach Tejan was an awesome, animator, designer, and illustrator who was jumping in on this stuff. Kevin Lee was in the mix. And then we had all sorts of additional, you know, design and animation support from Naki Din, Peter Esesny, Dan Wineland, and Vlad Linsenko, who's our man in Moldova, crushing it on all sorts of stuff.
Incredible.
So
that you're doing all this
man in Moldova
memory.
TM. That's yes. What,
hang on. Do you have a cheat sheet that
no,
is sitting?
That
next
was
to
all
your,
memory.
Next
he did it all
say,
entirely
I'm so
from memory.
I'm so glad he did that, and
just
I didn't
ran
that.
All these names by.
I am.
He's making all
of
them up.
I had to fast forward to the end of the episode on Disney Plus to read the credits as they scroll by. But no, I mean it's Doug and I love chatting with you guys about this stuff. But it's really important that, you know, everybody's aware. Like, I mean, it's an insane amount of work that goes into putting these things together. And with this, because we were making a sequence for episode one that was totally tailored to the backstory of Kate Bishop. And then episode two, there's a completely different, not a single frame shared sequence at the end of that episode that then is updated in the subsequent episodes. We effectively had kind of like two teams running in parallel as we were doing this. And there would have been no, I mean, making these things is always incredibly difficult, but it would have been damn near impossible to get two done at the same time if we didn't have an awesome team. And like the whole time, like, you know, we're not just slugging away on making these things, but we're like figuring it out, making giant sweeping changes to the story, the narrative, the style, like across the board. So there's like this project probably has like one of the sickest cutting room floors of any project that we've ever worked on. That will,
because you had so many great ideas that just weren't working, but they were amazing ideas.
The series as a whole, or just your intro?
Weeks that, you know, had to get cut out because then it doesn't fit with the story of the show anymore, or something like that. So, some really cool cutting room floor stuff that we'll probably never see the light of day because typically that stuff doesn't.
Your cutting room, not their cutting room, right? Or are you talking about the show itself?
Our cutting room.
Okay. Our cutting room. But I mean, show itself, I mean, these shows are constantly evolving, changing and shifting and adapting right down to the wire. I don't think it's a secret that like Marvel are masters at like using every last inch of runway that they have. And whereas I think like a lot of other like studios and productions would approach using up all that runway or doing reshoots as this sort of like sign of failure or like this wasn't planned out enough, they go into it knowing like we're gonna do a couple weeks of reshoots. Oh, what are you reshooting? We don't know yet, but we're gonna just assume that when we play down the director's cut, there's gonna be opportunities to make it better. And when we see those opportunities, we won't just be sad about them, we'll actually like act on them and improve it. And so this stuff, the clay isn't solid for quite a while.
Well, I mean, this is in the DNA of the Marvel Cinematic Universe. Iron Man, the first one, was basically improv the whole way through, as the actors tell it. Like it was being written on the set, very first movie in the MCU.
The thing is, that's also incredibly common. I mean, more common than people realize in movies. But let me just tell you how movies are made. but no, yeah, I agree. Like I think that's one of the things that makes these movies so good across the board creatively, is that things are allowed to be fluid, like or they are going to be no matter what. And I think every part of the team seems to understand that and allow the things like that are like the clay, allow the clay to not be like fully formed, like when it doesn't need to be. And clearly you guys are good collaborators with them and able to like roll that way because you keep, you know, working with them.
Years back, we worked on a superhero movie that was with a different studio. And it was appalling to me that we finished work on the movie in, I think it was like August or something. And the movie came out like the following spring or summer.
And when the movie came out, they were just like, it's done, it's good. Like, how?
Like when the movie came out, it was one of the most like universally panned films like ever made with a large budget. And it just astounded me that like months in advance, everybody like sat around and looked at it and were just like, it's good. Like, don't change a thing. Nailed it. Perfect. and the sense that we get from Marvel is that like always, like it's always like the Technicolor needs the final files in 24 hours. Is there anything else that we can do to just like enhance this aspect of the characters, or, you know, add a little more polish or sophistication here or whatnot?
It's wonderful. Now,
you've done title sequences for and other work on a lot of these movies. Is there much of a difference in how the film title sequences get made versus the TV shows for Marvel?
I think so. Process-wise, it's largely the same. I think the biggest difference is one of the things we've been doing with the TV shows is updating them every episode. Even if we're not updating the picture, the credits get updated every episode, and that might change based on this episode there's only three characters in this one, but this episode has 15 characters, so now we got to change that edit a little bit. But even beyond that, we go in and try and add little things every episode that kind of evolve it throughout the series. You know, for instance, like Loki, we updated the there's a shot of like a file folder on a table with pictures of Loki. In every episode, we changed all those pictures, which is like a little thing that it's not really a big deal. It's not a hint. It's nothing, but it's just kind of a fun thing for people to be like, oh, this episode they added, you know, Sylvie into it, or this episode is all the variant Lokis are in there. I'd say that's the biggest, to me, the biggest difference is that we have these rolling deliveries. So we have to, our base one is done, you know, whatever date it's done. And then for the next 3 or 4 weeks, we're still updating and evolving the sequence.
The other piece of the puzzle is like narratively, when you're doing a main on end title sequence that appears at the end of a film, you've just finished the entire film, and like we can right. do something that celebrates every aspect of that story. Whereas when we're working on a television series, it's like it's got to work in episode one, where you still have, you know, 80% of the story left to unfold and tease out and like sort of like entice you with. And we've been finding that, you know, again, super fortunate to work on these Marvel properties because they have such a strong fan base, and people are scrounging through the title sequences looking for clues about what's coming in upcoming episodes and things like that. So it's something we have to plan very carefully for and tiptoe the line between spoilers and stuff that's just, you know, gently alluding to broad themes.
Yeah. Well, I think a good example of that is WandaVision, the title sequence. In my mind, everything, knowing everything in hindsight, in my mind, the title sequence spoils the whole show, because you start off with the footage of Wanda and Vision together, but then you move into Vision's eye, which is pixelated, so that starts to give away, like, oh, Vision is made up out of this TV part, and all of the different pieces are getting built up, and then towards the end of it, the whole world gets destroyed, which is at the end of the show, the whole world gets destroyed. And then it's finally put back together with like the two rings saying like their relationship is this thing that kind of lasted the whole time. And that's the thing, we can kind of tease those elements, and it's very kind of obtuse, and you wouldn't really get it unless someone's like, well, this was our intent of the whole thing. But I think when you look at that, you're like, oh, that does spoil the whole show. But in a way that like you might pick that up when you watch it for the sixth time, as opposed to watching it the first time.
I think also on the other side of that, though, I think it provides hope to anybody who might not be into those first two episodes, which I'm not a part of, but I've heard some idiots are not a fan of like the first two episodes, like because they feel like it moves a little slow and doesn't get to it. I think your intro actually implies like, no, there's something going on underneath this that we're going to get to, and it like keeps them attentive. That would be my argument if I were.
Yeah, and that was an important part too, because the first two episodes of WandaVision do not feel like a Marvel show, you know. No, and they wanted,
and I loved that.
Yeah, but they wanted a title sequence that felt like, no guys, just hang on, this is a Marvel show, just wait for it.
Yeah,
you know. And so I think that, I like to think that that worked out.
Yeah, well, I mean, I think it did, based on how well received the show was.
Everyone loves WandaVision.
Yeah, and it's one of my favorite title sequences ever, period. I think I've told you guys that. It's so
thank
good.
You
you're welcome.
That's great to hear.
How long does it usually take you to come up, like, is there a like
some great audience
do they all
questions
take, do
week.
All take the same amount of time roughly, or do some title sequences take longer to kind of make than others?
Like, I like to say the ballpark time frame is like 3 months to put one of these things together, but we often, that's becoming more and more, I think, optimistic, and we're finding ourselves doing them in 2 months. I won't even say the period of time in which one of our Hawkeye title sequences was assembled from like nothing, from there being like zero imagery to final, because it was recklessly tight turnaround. But yeah, it's sometimes a wild ride on these things.
Well, the Philip from the chat says that the sequences for Hawkeye lifted an already amazing show into an even more enjoyable one, especially since they're a fan of the AJ run of comics. Now, is the director of the movie or the producer of the TV series involved heavily in these title sequences?
I love that Hashi and I are not having to host a show right now. The audience has this. The audience has everything they need, and we're just going to sit back and listen to these amazing answers.
Yeah, there's the director involved in the show. Yeah, I think it depends on the show. Something like WandaVision had one director who was in charge of every episode, right? That was Matt Shakman. Loki, Kate Herron was in charge of every episode. But then we get to something like Hawkeye where the director has changed. So that way, like, the director is not as involved, but it's more the producers being involved. So I think it kind of depends on the show and how they, on their end, have structured sort of who are the creative leads on the show. But the movies, the directors, you know, are, you know, they're involved in everything.
Do you, do you have, like, personal favorites in pantheon so far? Or are they, like, children you can't really pick a favorite?
Of title sequences?
Or are they, like, children where you can pick a favorite?
No, I didn't mean the directors. We don't need to be like, oh, this producer was a jerk.
You use your favorite child as a bargaining chip to get better behavior out of your children? Is this not...
Who wants to be favorite child today? I have maple syrup. I'm guessing maple syrup is what you use up in Canada as a currency, Hashi.
We use it for everything up here to power our cars, our days.
Now that Hashi has crossed the border, he's a native Canadian.
He's been there one day, and he's already filled his gas tank with maple syrup, assuming that's what he's supposed to do. Wait, what was the question? Which one of your kids is your favorite?
The question was, which one of your children is your favorite?
Johnny, I'll let you go first. You have multiple children.
yes. I'm very partial to our experience on Black Panther because it, like, ran the gamut of all the stuff that we do. And it also, for me, was like a paradigm shift in how we approach stuff, the work on, and sorry, like, someone start like a shot clock for me because I could go on for the next 90 minutes about this. But, like, the process started with us just being asked to have a call with the director to talk about different ways that future technologies, you know, are evolving and could possibly be applicable to his film. And we did a sort of like debrief or a tech audit that also had us honing in on like a core technology paradigm that struck a chord with him and everyone else working on the film. And we really quickly ramped up into doing a lot of like very conceptual development before the film had even started proper production while they were still finishing up the script. And the work that we did on these like really wild technology paradigms for the world of Wakanda ended up informing all these other things that were in the film, including like way more tech and gadgets than we initially expected, but also turned into like an opening prologue sequence that like tells the history of Wakanda, as well as a closing main on end credit sequence that, you know, to me it was all, and like all of that stuff, it was like the perfect blend of clever ideas and kind of like strategy driving it all, but also some amazing execution of work. And like kind of to me, like that sweet spot of motion graphics where it's like rad conceptual idea, but also like excellent technical execution, crazy Houdini particle sims and all sorts of stuff to kind of realize it and make it all come together.
Yeah.
That was, I also like my kids, Jacob and Gianna. That's
but in not Greg.
Shout
you
out.
Don't
to
like
Joe.
Greg. That was a very special one. That one like transcended that with the movie, just like transcended the idea of a title sequence. It was just such a special thing on screen to see with the rest of the movie. I don't think I said anything of substance just then, but
no, like I think you called out something interesting because companies don't just hire you for title sequences; they do hire you for tech consultations too. Like films isn't the only thing you do. Like you've been hired by car companies and other places to kind of help push tech in different ways, right?
It's a very big thing for us. It's actually about 50% of our work is in, you know, I used to say film, but I guess now it's like entertainment because it's like films, it's streaming, gaming, and doing, you know, we do put a really big emphasis on this idea of like fictional tech that appears in film. We love doing that stuff. We love trying to make it go beyond the, like, you know, the paradigm of just glowing blue shit floating everywhere and instead, you know, evolve things to... These ideas are concepts that get audiences curious about the rest of the world or society that's supporting all of this stuff. But that same kind of thinking or approach around the future of technology has us doing a ton of work on real world technology products with anyone from giant technology brands whose names I'm forbidden from saying out loud to car companies to niche, you know, industries like military grade cybersecurity or aerospace stuff or whatnot. And like all of that work takes this whole other layer of, you know, user experience and human-centered design thinking applied to it in order to be successful, because it's not like a style frame contest. It's, yeah, you have to make an experience that's going to somehow improve someone's life. But I also like to think that everything that we learn in that whole space carries over into the work that we do in film, and like particularly on a movie like Black Panther, it had us pushing these ideas and these concepts that had a strong like logic. And we have like a whole breakdown about like how that technology of floating vibranium sand is actually feasible if you have ultrasonic sound waves and the material is lightweight enough that it can be translated and articulated in 3D space and, you know, all this stuff. But because it has that like that realistic foundation underneath it, we like to think it's more believable for the audience. And quite honestly, it also makes like the collaborative process with the filmmakers go a lot better, because we can explain these concepts to them in a way where it's not just like, hey, do you think our art looks cool? But instead they're, you know, able to understand the logic or the principles that are driving it or underpinning it.
Speaking of Black Panther, if you're interested, audience, in recreating some of the look of the end title sequence, Red Giant has posted a little handy link. If you've got some time after the show, I want to click on that. You can watch Hashi's tutorial on remaking the Black Panther end titles, but without Houdini.
Is it ever infuriating to you guys to see someone like Hashi recreate your work in 2 days when it took you, you know, it took you months to do?
I love it because I like looking at these things and being like, God, we're so stupid. Why didn't we just do that?
It's the path of development. Like once you get the look developed, then you can figure out how to create it maybe in a different way. But your work is so much is finding that path in the first place.
It's look dev. Yeah, so much of it is look dev. Like that's what takes the most time, I think, more than just the execution, I imagine, for you guys. I mean, I think it is for most people. Oh, Hashi's back. We'll bring him up, talk about him. That's, by the way, the appropriate response to a Hashi tutorial is, oh, I'm an idiot. I could have done it that way.
Michael said it right. I mean, the process of developing the look is the crazy journey and challenge you get to completely skip if you're mimicking effects, which is great. Like that's why I feel like when like a secondary studio is doing like the graphics package for like a Capri Sun ad or something like that, they get to like mimic the effects of the movie because they're done already. They don't have to do any thinking. They just
Title sequence development or visual effects development is so tricky when you're in the development stage, because the director has something in their head and they can't speak. Like directors can't talk.
No, they don't.
Like I want to go. And you're like, that's not words.
Directors.
Yeah, I think
don't
famously
anything.
Mute. I think directors are.
No, but like it's very hard when you have something in your head there's no visual reference for, which is what a lot of this stuff is. Like you said, the Black Panther stuff, there's no visual reference for how that's going to work until you developed it. And there's a long, hard road to work it out. Now, you said, you mentioned some software that you've used. Is most of your work, when you get down to the nitty gritty, like hands-on, is it mostly After Effects and Cinema 4D that you all use?
Yeah, it's After Effects, Cinema 4D, kind of our bread and butter. And, you know, Johnny mentioned Houdini. We'll delve into Houdini. Some other things here and there, but it is 90% of the time it's going to be After Effects and C4D.
That makes a really good segue.
Some good art you got up there, Seth.
Well, that makes a really good segue into our next segment, but the thing is, I want to talk about this breakdown. I haven't watched it yet. Hashi put it in the footage folder. Does this look familiar to you guys?
This does look familiar.
So what is this that we're looking at? Like, what is that?
So
it's brilliant.
This, we made a quick breakdown of how we did just one of these shots in Hawkeye from that first frame, that beautiful first frame.
Yeah, that's my favorite thing you've ever done.
That is the storyboard that went in front of the client. Hey, we have an idea. There's a shot. where it's an arrow hitting a target, and like, that's it. We sign off. Great, love it. We love that an arrow hits a target, right? And then, you know, we go into building the look and drawing all the stuff, and then trying to figure out, well, how can we make this more than just this flat image? So we built it out in Cinema, projected our, essentially our style frame, projected that into Cinema, put a little camera move on there. And that is, you know, the 20-second version of how something like that gets made.
I love that arrow that hits and doesn't stick.
Like any, yeah. I love the look of 2D stuff in 3D space. So you projected the 2D drawing onto the 3D models, and that's the technique you used for these here?
Yes, that's the technique we used for this shot. And then some of the stuff in the far background is not projection. It's just, you know, flat cards that are off.
I just
want
to say, like, since I've got you guys here, I know how hard it is to make stuff read visually when you have such a limited color palette. And you've got such busy frames. Some of these shots are busy, and yet everything is, like, you could see everything is, you can tell what everything is. And I props to all y'all for that, because that is, so a lot of folks who are watching aren't going to understand, that was a ton of work to make that happen.
Thanks. Yeah, it gets, thank you. It's tricky because, you know, and because we're using silhouettes too, it's a little harder. Because if you have just a photo of someone pulling a bow and arrow, you're like, oh, it's a person pulling a bow and arrow. But if you silhouette that and you can't see the gap between the arm and their body, they just look like a blob. So you kind of have to... Yeah. Rotate them away and, you know, make sure that the silhouette is strong first to get that, like, iconic movement, or something like, you know, this, to make sure you have, you know, the target separated from the background in a way that makes it all easier to see.
What's
the tricky part of this?
Go ahead. Go ahead.
No, that was just my end of my thought.
I mean, is that arrow hand animated, or is that dynamics? That's what I want to know.
That I believe is, I want to find the file name for it, but probably, a clip of some kind of explosion that we threw in there and treated to make it,
I meant the arrow itself, but
the one that bounces
the one that bounces, that's hand animated.
You didn't build the tension of the bow to launch the, but like this technique, I think, is, you know, something that we come back to a lot, this idea of like projecting onto super primitive geometry, because it just, like, to me, it's so tried and true. It always nets this really cool result. And I think, you know, Michael, something you bring up is just this concept of like visual, like flat artwork that appears unusually 3D. To me, like, that gag never gets old. It's really beautiful. I can actually show something really quick.
Ooh,
that
yes.
I have.
It's
my favorite version of this technique that Doug made years back when we were developing the Marvel Studios logo animation, where we were given access to this incredible, brilliant concept art that they use for all their films. And we played with this idea of seeing the concept art get like painted on frame by frame, but not just, you know, seeing it painted on. We wanted to dimensionalize it. And Doug, you set up this awesome rig, and like I just this thing, whenever this is on, I could like stare at this on loop for like 30 minutes at a time.
100% agree. I loved this. When I was sitting in the theater and saw this for the first time, I about jumped out of my chair, and like no one else in the theater cared as much as I did, because I understood like how it was made. And I was like, this is beautiful. I love this.
It's so good.
The thing that's cool about it though also is like, if the artwork's really good, the models can be really sloppy. Doug, what do we refer to this process of projecting onto like
our basketball bodies?
Yeah, our bag of basketballs that's roughly in an approximate shape of a human, and it'll work, it'll read, it'll connect. There's one I won't bring it up because I think I've been previously asked not to share it, but the like the version of Black Widow that appears in the studio, in the Marvel Studios logo, like the raw geometry for it is like horrifying. Like she looks like a mutant beast, you know, made out of, you know, cylinders and cubes. And
I don't know why you'd be asked not to share that. That doesn't.
Yeah.
Now, when you're rendering, like say for example, Hawkeye, you've got a 3D. Are you just using the Cinema 4D standard render with Luminant materials to make that happen? Mm-hmm. Or are you using something else?
Yeah, that's the bulk of it. Because stuff like that, you know, we don't need anything too fancy, and it renders super quickly. So, you know, that's the way we're rendering that stuff out. There might be some, not in Hawkeye, but I guess there might be other reasons to use.
I mean, I know you used Redshift in WandaVision, as main on ends.
Yeah. Yeah, so WandaVision was all Redshift, but for something like Hawkeye, you know, the standard render luminance materials does the trick for what we need.
Mm-hmm. I do actually, Seth, if you want to go over, I have that geometry they were projecting onto. Check this out. So that's what went in. It's incredible, really.
Wow, that's actually a new character in the Marvel Universe that hasn't been.
Oh my gosh, I'm so sorry.
You just completely spoilers.
Let me put that away.
Disney's going to get onto us now.
What if that did kick us off YouTube? You know, last time it was the Hawkeye 80s intro. What if that clip was like the, we didn't know it was the most pirated, like the most copyrighted clip.
They've just been fighting for decades to keep it out of the hands of.
Well, are we ready to move away from stuff that's already been made and start making clips. Some of our own things, Seth?
We are, you know, Michael, whose show is this, Michael? What, you know what?
Just asking.
If only I had a button. He's gone. No, I'm just kidding. Oh, keep him. We love him. Hey. So Michael's absolutely right. If someone could say the word After Effects so that I could segue us. Michael, say After Effects, please.
After Effects.
Speaking of, great segue, we are doing a segment this week. So last week, you know, Hashi, why don't you give some backstory of what we did last week and how we're going to do similar this week.
So we had so much fun in one of our older episodes where we were combining the Fast and the Furious with Jurassic World clips. And we thought we should have a feature every month where we have to mash two things together. And so we came up with something called VFX Royale. And VFX Royale is where we take a bunch of audience suggestions for fictional characters and pull clips from them and then use a spinner wheel to play a game where each artist has to make two random creatures fight on air, which was a ton of fun.
I have a couple clips I can share to show that. As soon as I, you know, you'd think that I would have prepared this.
So, for example, I had tweeted out that we wanted to do this, and I got a lot of amazing audience responses. And so the suggestions ranged from like Cookie Monster to Care Bears, Porgs, Terminators, the worm from Dune, Paddington, Winnie the Pooh. Seth brilliantly put them all on some spinner wheels so we could all get an exciting assignment. And
can you guys include Mac from Mac and Me in that list?
Oh my gosh.
What?
I think we definitely did feature
How
Mac
did Mac not end up on the wheel? What is we that is a huge disservice. Ooh, that we
that have. Is it's an oversight for sure. I think that we should figure out how to make sure that Mac works his way into this episode.
Yeah, I think we should. Well, I'm having trouble finding Hashi's render from last week, but I have real quick just a clip, just because we got a little bit of time. I've got a clip here of here's a clip from last week's show.
We have decided that we're going to play this game called VFX Royale, where me, Seth, and Michael are going to take random pairings of these characters for which we have pre-grabbed a bunch of clips to make fights. Let's jump into it. Let's get started. We're going to get into After Effects right away.
All right, Hosh, you're first up. You want to spin that wheel? Or those wheels?
All right, I'm going to spin the wheel. Ready?
Cookie Monster versus Godzilla.
Cookie Monster versus Godzilla.
Next up is me. Here we go. Spin.
Yes.
Oh, boy. This is what I hoped.
Oh my god.
He got the Care Bears.
I got the Care Bears.
So we ended up making, I did Paddington versus Dune, where he, Dune Worm, where he did the hard stare toward the Dune Worm. Hashi did this amazing render. I really wish I knew where that freaking thing was, of Cookie Monster and Godzilla. But this week, when I find it, I'm going to come back and play it at in completely apropos of nothing. But for now, why don't we do our this week's segment where Hashi actually give us the, or you guys want to give us the heads up? It was you guys' idea, Perception.
This was. So, yeah.
Yeah. I think this came out of the last time we talked. We had joked around about it a little bit of doing a challenge. I don't have a catchy name like VFX Royale for it, but doing a challenge of using the most basic, widely considered worst effects in After Effects to make something cool.
And yes.
Wait, because nobody's like, ooh, CC hair is great. But, yeah. You know, if you push it, you can get some cool stuff.
Yeah, exactly. I think everyone's probably a fan of CC ball action. And if you're not, you really need to get into some CC ball action.
You really need
action.
Some more ball action in your life, everybody.
Yeah. Everyone needs the proper amount of ball action. So we don't have a catchy name for it, but that doesn't stop us from doing it.
Yeah. So far, I've been calling it the CC Showdown.
Hey, I like it. CC Showdown. I don't have a graphic for it, but Hashi, you want to actually, let's let our friends from Perception roll first.
Yeah.
John, you're going to go first, all right?
All right. Lay it on me. What do we got here?
Wave World.
Yes, Wave World. Yes.
All right.
Wave World. I love Wave World. This is gonna be a good one. I have faith in you.
And what are we doing with these again? We're just making something cool. That's the only
something
cool.
Make something cool.
Pushing it. I think, twerking it. Twirling
so if
with
we
it.
Can, if we can give ourselves a limit, I think what we should do is make each other a cool Twitter profile picture.
We're going. We're, and then are we minting these?
Yeah, and then we're never going to mint them.
Okay, great. All right, going back to the wheel. Doug, you're up next.
Wait, which way am I? This way.
CC Twister.
CC Twister, all right.
CC Twister.
Is that a thing? Does it just... It just pulls clips from Twister. I don't actually know what CC Twister does.
I hope so.
Yeah, it actually
you launch
just
it, and After Effects drives through a house.
Yeah, it drives through a house, and then Bill Pullman pops up, and you're like,
"I'm pretty sure it's a '50s technique for breaking sexual tension."
Is watching the film Twister starring Bill Paxton? Yes, I knew what you meant, but I'm taking it that way.
Bill Paxton. I messed it up. Sorry.
Hey, I'll welcome Bill Pullman to the mix. Can you imagine like a reboot or a direct sequel where Bill Pullman just took over Bill Paxton's role and no one said anything? Speaking of, again, not at all relevant. Hashi, we're going to spin.
Speaking of Pullman, let's pull that lever, man.
CC Jaws.
CC Jaws. Cool. That adds a shark to things, right?
Know what that one is.
Yeah. I don't either. And
CC Jaws.
CC Jaws is what they called me in high school. No, I'm sorry. Mr. Smoothie is what they called me in high school.
Mr. Smoothie.
God in heaven. Why did I agree to this? Oh. Okay.
Okay, so to recap, we are all going to try to take the most obscure After Effects logos, and we are all going to make Twitter profile pictures for each other using them. So John has Wave World. Mm-hmm. Doug was assigned, I forgot. CC Twister.
Twister.
I have CC Jaws, and Seth over there is Mr. Smoothie.
CC Mr. Smoothie. That's CC Mr. Smoothie to you.
You always got a CC Mr. Smoothie.
I just was playing with CC Mr. Smoothie just the other day. I think you can get some great stuff with this. Throw on some footage and watch what happens.
I'm not worried because I have Michael. See, what we don't. I don't know if you guys realize this, but this is how Hashi does most of his stuff. Like, most of the amazing stuff he does uses everything on this wheel. So, like, our asses are going to be handed to us through this process.
Yes, we are very much outnumbered here.
But what's great is I'm comforted because I have Hashi, we have Hashi and Michael here to explain to us how what these things do. So let's start off by how do we start this off? Because I want to learn what these things are while we're doing them, and we're all kind of opening up After Effects and getting started.
So, John, are you familiar with Wave World? Oh, yeah, I was worried I'd have to like Google every single one of these, and like Wave World is the one obscure one that I'm like I'm loosely familiar with, and Hashi, correct me if I'm wrong, but Wave World will create a ripple of waves that could collide against, you know, an edge or a bounding shape.
Yes,
and it creates a displacement map.
Basically.
Yeah, it's genuinely like a kind of physics simulation under the hood. You can actually drive how deep the surface, the ground, the water is, how close to the surface the water is by another layer as a map, which will affect how the ripples on the surface happen. So you can either have it output a wireframe of this 3D world with the waves going, which could be cool for FUI stuff. I don't know if you know anything about that. Or you can have it output a grayscale map, which you can then use as a displacement map to drive a water surface or something else in visual effects world. Wave World is really crazily advanced for how long it's been in After Effects.
Yeah, and like the rad thing about it is not just that it'll make like, you know, ripples moving outwards, which isn't that big a deal, but when they collide against the edge, it's ideal if you have like a pool. You know, something that has, you know, a body of water that has a limit or an edge that the waves will collide against and bounce around.
I'm to quote you before the show, how dare you humanize Wave World for us as we get moving in. I love that we're going, if we do our jobs right here, we're going to be sponsored by Adobe next week.
Yeah, fingers crossed.
So now,
I'm in our Skype chat. I'm sharing a little clip that if you want to use as a source or something like that, I think that it's fair if we all start with the same thing.
Hashi, I have this clip already loaded.
Perfect. Yeah.
Let's pull it up for those of you at home. I'll just say this is the thumbnail that came up immediately, and it is, where'd it go? This is the thumbnail that came up.
Yep.
Chat. So, okay.
That's my dude right there.
That's the best, a perfect starting point.
All right, I'm going to.
Who are we going to first? Let's see, who is up? Whose screen is up right now of you guys? I know that we've got the split screen with me and Hosh, but John, is your screen up? I think
that's Johnny's screen.
Let's see.
I'm still downloading stuff right now.
All right, sounds good. So I've got my mine open over here, and I'm going to just add a solid for a second to figure out what CC Jaws does. So let's CC Jaws. Added it.
What does CC Jaws do? I have no concept whatsoever of what that is.
It's a transition.
It chomps.
It's exactly what you think.
Wait.
Makes Charlie Brown sweaters.
Look at Spike's Robo Jaw.
Whoa!
Oh look, it's the thing from the
futuristic door.
Palace.
Rancor door, right?
Yeah.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
Little Rancor door blocks. Oh, just straightforward. Okay. Mm-hmm. I like that. And then waves. That makes sense. Yes, waves. Oh, so every time I've wanted like this as my backdrop, I could have had this with one.
CC Jaws.
Anytime you're making designs to be printed on paper cups.
Yes. Oh man. Okay. So CC Jaws is a transition, like a that just opens and closes, and you can you can set the direction. Oh, I love it. I love it. Okay. So that's what I got. Seth, what were you assigned again?
I was assigned, hold on, I'm just real quick setting this guy up. I was assigned Mr. Smoothie, CC.
Oh, yes, Mr. Smoothie. I don't know what Mr. Smoothie does.
Oh, boy. Well, I don't either. It's time to find it. I could just Google it first, but should I drop it on the footage itself?
Yeah.
Why not? Why not?
Well, yeah, it does that.
100% drop it on footage.
This is exactly what you would expect it to do. So it looks like I can reference a map, a flow layer. So maybe I'll create a new solid. Displacement.
So you've got a... So it uses another layer to inform what it's doing to another. Sort of like glass or something, right?
So I'm just going to try like creating a map and referencing that.
Okay.
And it looks like it... What is
it?
What it, is it doing? I don't understand.
I don't understand either. It's making it all wobbly weird. Yeah, I suppose so.
This is like your Colorama Electrify
something
thing.
Something cool happened there for a second.
That's kind of like a Colorama kind of thing.
It is like a Colorama thing. It's got a phase and a color loop, AB. What is this?
Is that color based on the footage?
It's based on whatever flow layer I select. At what point is it encouraged to open up Google and look in the... Adobe.
That's a good question. Well, first of all, let's also throw to Doug and see what.
Hold on. Let me
basics of CC Twister.
Yeah.
Are you sharing, Doug?
No, I will be in one second. Let me make sure I got the right screen. Start sharing. All right. Can we see what we got here? CC Twister does this.
Ooh. Okay. Another transition-y effect.
Yes, it looks like my options are limited to just this.
But is this a checkbox twist, yes or no? Yeah.
And then the backside layer, I've put another fractal on it, but I could have a different object on the backside.
So you can have two different...
So I can twist from one to the other.
Okay.
So let's see if I... Finally. Let me look at this. This was my backside, and we can just... let's see, what do you want to do on this guy? You know, just because I like it, I'm going to throw a little color around on here. Yes, I still use that menu. That's how far back I go. All right. There we go. I can twist from one to the other.
All right.
So I'll figure out what to do with that. Let's see, then shading. Right. Pretty obvious. I got shading. I can move my center point. It seems like only up and down works as an option, but left and right has no effect, but up and down.
Ooh, and then, that's kind of cool. Oh, like whoa. The corners. You can get into the corners like that.
Ah,
can you set the center somewhere?
Yeah, so I can move it like that. Ooh. Oh, this starts to look like it's
moving
like
an hourglassy or a... okay.
Yeah.
Could tie someone's stomach in knots or something. All right.
And I think those are my options.
All right. Well, okay. I am excited about this. I am curious, actually, on Jaws. I'm going to quickly add that to mine again. I don't know if Jaws... is just doing the alpha, or if it actually will take whatever was on that layer and move it.
Oh.
Nope, it's just an alpha
so
thing.
So you can't do like chatting mouth, but you could probably do a displacement map with it that was parented to that and actually push Mac up and down with it.
Maybe? Precisely. That's a good idea. Yeah, we could expression link something that moves things up and down. So like if I raised that would actually do something. Okay, I can work with this. So this is always the super engaging part of the show. Feel free, if you're in the chat, to suggest things to us or ask questions of our amazing guests who have worked on literally every Marvel movie since Marvel was a thing. So we have a wealth of knowledge and a really limited tool set to try to show off that wealth of knowledge today.
Yes, give me any excuse not to embarrass myself with CC Twister.
CC Twister.
I'm just getting this clip up onto my machine so we can have the best that Mac and me has to offer.
Perfect. All right, he keys pretty well using Primac here.
Well, that's good.
So, you know.
Thank God.
Yeah, I don't know where I'd be if that wasn't the case.
And I haven't even made it very far into the clip. I just know that it has this clip in it. So let's see. Let's do a quick scrub through just out of curiosity.
Oh. Well, I'm bringing them back. Don't worry. They're coming back.
That clip.
Yeah. Although chased by this one's pretty good.
They don't know. Every audience, they have no idea that they were lost from the show for a split second. So don't tell them.
Let's see.
You guys were
this
here.
Is up by my old house. This is where I just moved away from. Let me see.
Oh yeah, that is. They literally
see what?
Can you see your house there?
Yeah, it's Killamore. Okay, so yeah, I lived on I lived up a block from here. This is the same hill as the ET van bike chase.
Oh, cool.
So I lived in my Google Maps. There's a street right here at the top. I lived right here.
I feel like we're going to see CC Twister show up in a Marvel title sequence soon after today's episode.
I mean, if something, if I come up with something now, you have no idea. I mean, you can ask Johnny. It is my favorite thing in the world to use these effects on these Marvel things, just because like no one expects that. Like CC glass is the bulk of an effect somewhere, you know.
It's true.
It brings me totally true. No small amount of pleasure just to be like, this whole effect was done with Colorama.
That's incredible.
All right, something like the what was it? The WandaVision titles, that like distortion effect that we have. That was all built with a mix of displacement maps. CC glass is in there somewhere. Because it does a really nice job at like stretching when you get the right kind of maps in there. Let's see what else. There's something else in there that was that you wouldn't expect, but yeah, I enjoy doing that.
I want to see if let's see. First, I'm gonna make a. I want to make some kind of like Jabba the Hutt style door thing. So I'm going to just create a solid, and then I'm going to randomly add some noise to it. And we'll make that, I'm not going to use color noise. And then I'm going to add, let's see, fast box blur, change that to horizontal only or vertical only, and turn that up. This is kind of the old like Photoshop brushed steel cheat. You could do, let me turn the amount of noise down. And I don't know why I used this purple solid. I think I was still in my sample from your title sequence color over here from Hawkeye. Let's see, what do we got? Oh, Seth's got the help
up. Shit, I can't. Oh. I gotta know.
Boo.
I know.
Yeah, I'm sputtering over here on trying to figure out how to get Wave World to give me. I thought the key to Wave World was having like a defined shape for your pool, but I'm having trouble getting it to feed in my my desired shape.
See, the way I would use Wave World is to, like, create a displacement map or something to put into Cinema.
Yep. It works like exceptionally that. Well with chromatic displacement from the VFX suite. But we're trying to go native today with these plugins.
Guys, I'm finding no documentation, just videos. I don't want to watch a video on our show. There's no documentation on what this does.
That was my concern, is that
which effect was yours?
Mr. Smoothie.
You get a phone a friend.
Hang on.
We have Michael here. What are you on the internet for?
I love the idea of like Who Wants to Be a Millionaire? One of the lifelines being just like you get 10 minutes to YouTube something.
I was worried that the beginning of this was really going to be us just like watching YouTube for about 10, 15 minutes.
Doug, Steve just sent me a hint.
Oh,
I just got a message that just pinged me. Suggesting
get out of here.
Transfer.
Lifelines. Do you got secret lifelines? Where are my friends texting me? I got CC Jaws. I need something. Oh, man. Wait, Nick, you just came through with something. It does look like Vader's hyperbaric chamber. Wait a second.
Yeah, I know where this is going.
Everyone knows where this is going now. Straight
into CC Sphere or possibly Video Copilot's Orb if you want something that renders faster.
Oh, my gosh.
Michael, any luck figuring out what the hell Mr. Smoothie does? This is all my I'm going to be doing on this episode.
If you look into the Slack, I sent you a link to the manual.
Thank you,
Nick,
sir.
You are brilliant. Thank you.
Oh, no, I don't like the sound of that.
Manual?
Okay.
You sent me the manual.
Okay. I just sent you the let me Google that for you link.
Yeah, you did. That would be the best smart-ass thing for Michael to do in this moment. It's not here. Where is it?
I just popped it into the Skype chat too. It's just a link to download the manual because it's a PDF you can download. But it's all the it's the manual effects. For all the Psycore effects.
Okay.
Psycore. Now, was Psycore? Do they still independently exist, or are they?
Wait, is that what Adobe? CC stands for?
Yeah, it stands for Psycore.
What? It's not What?
It's not Creative Cloud.
It was. It was in. It was in After Effects since before Creative Cloud was a thing.
Yeah, but I didn't want to think about that. I just never knew. I thought it was like, oh, you know what? Let's use that Creative Cloud. Nope, I don't have an explanation for why I didn't know this.
Psycore is from Sweden. And yeah.
That's where Mr. Smoothie lives.
I did not know that.
So RoboJaws works perfectly as a hyperbaric chamber side thing. Let's find a position where it looks like it would tile. I think that would tile, right? And then if this, let's call this 01 texture. And then I try to get organized sometimes, but working fast is going to be difficult. All right, let's see. We'll throw that into another comp here, and then we'll add some CC sphere.
Gosh, this is a massive menu.
Transforms
the source layer into flowing psychedelic patterns. I know, but why? You can use
in a public setting, but
it's distancing itself. The manual distances itself from the effect. You can use it to create background textures or wild special effects. Okay.
Whoa.
Ooh.
Finally.
That's rough. If the word wild is used to describe something that's supposed to be engaging, then you've lost.
Kind of colorama, just with less controls.
Yeah.
All right. So
I'm trying to figure out something with this twister.
Hey, Doug and John, someone in the chat is asking if you make the titles that they use in the trailers too, or just the ones that are in the shows themselves.
We haven't done trailer work yet. Typically with the titles, the marketing is always kind of our base where we start because that's what people are used to. But we try and tweak it or sort of change it entirely depending on what the movie or the show calls for. Right, because the titles on the trailers are usually they're big, they're bombastic, they're energetic, they want to get you excited for the movie, but sometimes the movie ends and doesn't have that kind of tone to it, right? It's more of more subdued. I think a good example would be for Loki. The trailer for Loki had the big 3D letters that were constantly cycling, which looked great and it worked really well for the trailer. But for the titles of the show, it's much more subdued than that. So we took the trailer idea of the cycling letters, but then we made something that was a lot simpler, but also in a way more complicated because they were flatter, more graphic letters that were cycling, and they had more of a kind of analog feel to it.
I was curious which came first and how the fonts were chosen for that specific thing, but I guess if the trailers were done beforehand, you just kind of got the list, didn't you? And
no, we didn't actually use, I think there's maybe two fonts that they're like, hey, make sure you use these from the trailer, but do whatever you want. A lot of the fonts we chose, I guess here's a little Easter egg for you. A lot of the fonts we chose are fonts that have appeared in other movies that Loki was in.
Oh, brilliant.
So like We used fonts from the Ragnarok title sequence or the Endgame title sequence or Infinity War.
Damn it, that's so good. I love that.
We also used fonts from some of the comics. We pulled some fonts from there. And then a few from the actual from the titles, because they liked that one felt like it was part of a Renaissance fair, right? That kind of teases towards like episode two. So
that's so good.
Kind of pulled them from everywhere.
I love that.
All right, I think I've got an idea. It's not going to be an impressive one, but I think I've got something.
I'm looking at your screen, and it looks great. Done, right?
Done.
It's beautiful. It's like a metaphor for how the sands of time are.
John, how you doing?
I'm having a real rough time over here. I think I'm going to flip the script.
He was so excited about Wave World.
Oh, man.
I can't. I'm still having trouble getting Wave World to, like, I might even be thinking of a different plugin or something that I thought the whole purpose of it was that you could create the shape of your pool so that you could collide against, like, if you... You know, the collisions that it would make are the interesting thing against the edges. And I'm having trouble getting it out of, like, default rectangle shape.
Wait, chat, if you know what plugin he is talking about and or if there's a way to do it with what he has set up, let us know.
Now, alternatively, I think there's something that I can do that's just kind of fun with the fact that the wireframe preview of Wave World does. It's just like it gives you like a wireframey sort of view.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think that's the fun, is using the effect in a way that it might not necessarily be intended.
Yeah.
I stopped sharing my screen, so I'm not doing that anymore.
After Effects team has said that one of the odd things about After Effects is that it was built to do things that it was not built to do.
It's the best.
So go ahead and go crazy doing stuff it wasn't meant to do.
Whoa!
Look at that.
So,
and those waves will bounce off the edge of them, of like the tank and stuff. And then there's a... Like the checkbox, there's a checkbox in there that turns it into like the displacement map, right?
Yeah, so that's just like how you're viewing it, right? And I've got the displacement map going. And what I was trying to do was drive it with a simple hexagon shape and just say, hey, can I have this be the shape of my pool and bounce off the edges? But it doesn't seem to be responding to that in any way, shape, or form.
That is frustrating.
It's still just sticking to like a rectangular edge.
Yeah, it will just stick. I mean, hang on, let me try to see your screen better. Because you should be able to use the ground and feed another layer in to that.
Yeah, I was expecting like that could create like a shoreline that the waves would bounce against or something to that
effect. Put like a black and white, just basic shape.
Oh,
just
make it needs to be black and white.
Make a black and white shape, and then make it slightly somewhat feathered at least. Yeah, feather that out, and then switch to your, so I can see just your screen better, content view.
There we go.
Oh, cool. Whoa. Wait, no, it can use that.
Yep. Go back to the wireframe view. Seriously, feather that first though. Put a blur adjustment layer on over top of that, because it needs some gradation.
Yeah, it needs a little.
Yeah. Okay. Like that. There you go. Go back to your wireframe view. You can see what's actually happening under the hood. So there you go. That's what's so actually cool. happening.
Wait, so that's where does cool. it, where does it source that layer? That's down in the
in the ground.
It's in the ground setting. You feed it that layer.
It can affect the steepness, the height, all that kind of stuff, and then that will affect how the water moves.
That's frustrating. All right. Wait, Seth, go back to my screen for a second. I want to I got to acknowledge that this is, I did something in a really poor way before. I did a Matrix Mirror little tutorial of how to like put little ripples in the water. Yeah. And I didn't realize that I could just use Wave World and then switch it to the height map. Whoops, let me switch like this. And then now I have this perfect like simulation. You see, I used radio waves for this. Yeah. And there's a plugin that just looks like that natively. Because welcome. Like, check it out. If I made this like a 3D layer and then turned it sideways like this. Actually, I don't even need to turn it sideways. Whatever. I'm just going to leave it like that. And then if I add an adjustment layer up here with chromatic displacement. Now, for my displacement map, I can source my solid with its effects and masks and then turn up the displace amount. And now I have a perfect these perfect ripples.
God,
that sort of giggle noise is one of my favorite things about this show.
It's gorgeous.
Oh my God! If you could isolate that just on his, this over the eye
a little bit
alpha.
More, so I can. It's yes. I think we have a ooh.
Oh boy!
Keep in mind, you have the option to add a second wave producer, ripple producer.
Yep.
So right now you're only doing one, but you could put a second one on his other eye, and those ripples will interact with each other.
That is incredible. So wait, let me see. Displace them out. Wait. You know what? I'm getting a little bit lost doing this. Oh,
that's cool.
Look, he's alive.
I hope our viewers have some sort of substance they could take to really enjoy this particular visual.
Yeah, it's called CC Mr. Smoothie. It's down in the...
Just go to any local place where you acquire such things. Seth famously knows where to find all of the illicit substances.
Wow, people will believe you when really I don't know where they are.
He's clean.
My mom will believe you. My mom will watch this and believe you, Michael. You and I both know. I grew up in the most Christian environment you could possibly have grown up in which I didn't believe people did bad things in the world. Then I met you.
Were you homeschooled?
Huh?
Were you homeschooled? Because
no, I wasn't. No, I'm sorry. I wasn't the most Christian environment. It was a healthily Christian environment, but one in which I didn't learn where to find drugs.
I have no idea where people go to find them. Like, everyone's doing all these drugs. I'm like, I don't know where. There's no Drugs R Us down the road. Only it's Walgreens, but they don't sell that kind of stuff.
There's probably an app now. There's an app for everything. Anyway, this
if you out there know where to find drugs, put it in the comments.
It's going well. It's going well.
Another twister to this. What do you do if I have another twister? Oh, it just kind of overrides
on top of each other.
Twister. Yeah.
It doesn't like retwist it. Delete it. That's disappointing.
Yeah, just kind of double twists. So I don't know where I'm going with this. I've got, I can share my screen. Let me
disable my, there we go.
So I'll say, I don't know where I'm going, but I know I've gotten somewhere that I don't hate. Hey. Somewhere that I really
don't hate. Whoa! Oh boy.
So do these have to be stills that we render out, or can they be in motion?
I mean, this is probably as good as it's going to get.
Let's make a little compilation so these can be animated, right. 5 seconds or something like
we're
that.
We're minting them, yeah. So of course.
Because, yeah, like it's visual effects move usually. That's
here we go.
Gorgeous picture.
Well,
I like this moment right here.
Right?
Wow.
I'm going to feed that into an AI identifier and see if it can identify what it is right here.
Yeah.
It says hot air balloon over Grand Canyon.
Right, but now this has kind of given me an idea. If I were to go into this and, like, if I were to animate here, like, does he look like his head is coming out of Mac's neck? Let's see. Hold on.
Can you soften the, like, can you pinch in the amount of, like, the width of the twist?
I don't think so. Because I think it's twisting to turn it around. but now if I took this, and let's say pull you down here, and let's just move forward a little bit, bring it out. Does it look like Johnny is growing out of Matt's body? And I think, there we go.
Oh, that's so good.
All right. Now we're getting somewhere. We're getting somewhere with
Wow. Wow. This is why you give award winning artists these tools. This is all worth it.
All right.
So yeah,
I'm starting to get a weird idea of something that I can make happen here. And bear with me, because as always, whenever anyone's standing over my shoulder watching me do stuff, everything feels like it's trapped in slow motion.
This is honestly like the worst combination of I haven't prepared for my test at school, and a client is sitting right behind me as I'm working.
Try running an OBS stream while you're doing it and paying attention to a Slack and dealing with Michael's bullshit. No, I'm just kidding. All at the same time.
All right. So what I'm going for is I'm feeding in an animated displacement map so that if I flip this thing over, it will look like Mac has some sort of
Depeche Mode album.
I want him to have like a 3D visualization of the road that he is driving down, and have something.
Man. Oh, not Depeche Mode. Sorry, what's the album? I don't know why I said Depeche Mode.
Oh, Joy Division.
Joy Division. Yeah.
Well, let's see.
I'll get it right next.
I think this thing may not let me. It may not take an animated.
I feel like Foam, which is the bubble simulator that can use a black and white map as a flow map, but it can't be animated. I feel like this may be the same thing because it would have a very odd effect on the wave formation that it can't account for.
Mm-hmm. I'm beginning to realize that is the case. And once again, Wave World has screwed me.
Oh my gosh. It
always does.
All right.
Does anyone know what the name is of the alien species that Mac is a part of is?
Butthole? I actually don't know.
So Mac was like, the whole thing with Mac and Me is that it's a shameless ET ripoff. But that was like financed by McDonald's, right?
Yeah, because it has the whole birthday party scene, which is an amazing scene, by the way, if you've not seen it. It makes birthday parties at McDonald's look like
a rave.
Yes, it looks like it makes you want them immediately. Oh, I thought we were going somewhere with that was going to shed light into the species.
No, the chat. Someone in the chat said
that was just
commonly known that the Mac alien species can suck in their own heads and regenerate a human face, which is a funny comment, but made me think, does that alien species have a name? Because, you know, Wikipedia has got all kinds of stuff about the, you know, what kind of alien Yoda is, you know, and the history of the species and whatnot. I didn't know if there was a similar lore surrounding the Mac and Me alien.
There's got to be a wiki, you know, or something.
Oh, I'm sure there's something out there.
You know what?
Jason Murphy says it's the species is called ET-ish.
ET-ish. ET-ish, legally distinguishable from ET. All right, I am going to add another very silly effect to add, which is just the classic built-in lens flare. We work for a company that makes some amazing lens flares named after John Knoll. But we are going to, I'm just going to use a more boringer one.
I'm trying to think of what the like metaphor is for the use of like default lens flare and how generally unacceptable a move that is.
I mean, 90s design is coming back, and this lens flare was all over 90s motion design. So, you know, it could be on its way back. I think like, it's time for the next generation of lens flares, honestly, because like 90s had that. Stock AE lens flares, and then we had optical flare. Then all the life factor came out and sparked a whole bunch. Then optical flares came out, sparked a whole another wave of it. JJ Abrams didn't hurt, so I think it's time for another lens flare tool to come out and spark a whole another world of lens flares, because lens flares have largely disappeared from modern motion design. I think they need to come back.
They got a little bit of a bad rap for a while, but I think that
Hashi's bringing them back today.
Apologist.
It can be quite lovely. I always like to refer to the load-bearing lens flare as part of a
yes.
Comp. Yeah, I think it's a you know, the trick is just not using it all the way, not dumping all the lens flare on everything all at once.
I disagree.
It's like wasabi. Disagree. You have to pick an appropriate amount.
Yeah, I would say the Knoll light flare, Knoll light factory is a nice aioli, and After Effects stock lens flare is like store brand mayonnaise. Don't leave either out in the sun or else they'll turn to poison.
They will. All right, I've added my CC Jaws to this bizarro.
That's so good.
Jumping thing. Kind of loops.
Oh, that's cool.
Let's see. That wiggle is a little bit too intense for me. Let's turn it down to 6. And let's turn up the amount.
If this were VFX at Chill After Hours, I would have some jokes about your last comment, Hashi.
No jokes here.
We don't joke around. It's a very serious business.
Extremely.
CC serious.
Good God.
Right. So let's use built-in CC, glow.
CC Showdown, the C stands for serious.
All right. So I think I've referred to this as the Cremarian glow, where you have use the native After Effects glow with low intensity, small radius, and also you turn the threshold down, and then you duplicate the effect, and you crank that radius up even higher, turn the threshold up a little bit, and turn the intensity.
No, this works best if you're in a 32-bit project, and looks like trash if you're in an 8-bit project.
I'm doing the same exact move right now to make my wireframe preview of Wave World look like something that's not totally disgusting.
If you have the Red Giant VFX suite, you can just get a better go at it just using optical glow instead of having to try to stack stuff. But if you don't have it, this stacking of glow effects is a good way to do it.
Yeah, which is too bad, because like, look at this. I could just go to optical glow and it's going to look amazing already. Like, look at that stuff. You don't get that.
Wow.
This is intense, but like, look at this. And also, I could turn it up to highlights only, and then radiate it.
I love how
so
it
there's
like, it makes
shadows
it look
and
like
stuff.
There's it makes it look like there's like all this depth and detail in something that's like totally flat.
Yeah, and the radiate option makes it behave almost like Trapcode Shine, but just like a little bit, so you can have it like a tiny little hint of it, so it kind of has that radiant, or you can make it blow out way. There's so much control in there, especially when you start doing blur radius different for different color channels. So you can add some real subtle coloration to it that just adds, it's like adding a tiny bit of cumin into a recipe. It just, you can't taste the cumin, but it just feels better.
I'm not getting that same control here with built-in glow. But we're trying.
If you wanted to get that same sort of effect with the built-in glow, you could use one of the radial blur type things. But
that's true.
Not going to be as good.
Won't. That's all right. That's all right. Seth, how are you doing over there? You've been a little quiet.
I am exploring this idea of doing... So since it does what Colorama... Like, it's kind of doing Colorama thing, but with, like, slightly less steps than Colorama is requiring. I'm quickly trying to create, like, a depth mat of sorts from a depth Mac, if you will. And I'm going to try and... Hashi, you remember what I did for the T-Rex in our background on the show using a depth mat
yes.
in particular?
That was an incredible effect.
I'm just going to try and do that because I don't know if it's cheating to try and make something better than that's not super. I don't know. You guys are all making something awesome. So never mind. It's not cheating at all. So that's what I'm doing. I'm working on this weird depth Mac.
No, it's so cool. Wait, do you remember which background is it? It's this one. I'm just going to pull it up for the folks so they can see this effect kind of bigger. Let's see if I can make it any larger. There we go. So check out this craziness. Look at that.
I love when he goes That's off cool. is the coolest. Is like as he first, I love when he like disintegrates in the latter half. It's just a depth map. I use Colorama to cycle through the the luminance of the depth map and used that as the part as the emitter in particular, and so it
Oh, that's so cool.
So I'm just going to try and disintegrate Mac. Using
that's perfect.
Mr. Smoothie.
All right. I don't entirely know what I'm doing anymore.
The name of my autobiography. Disintegrating Mac.
Yeah, I'm a hot mess over here, and I'm continually reinventing what I'm trying to accomplish.
Can we see it?
Which is it's pretty much the process that I use. So I'm trying to.
Are we seeing your screen or Doug's? I'm sorry. It's
no,
really
that's
funny.
that is my screen. On the other screen, I'm trying to acquire some other footage so I can weave another shot into this narrative. Here we go. Okay, now I got a piece of footage here. Pull it, I want to try and get into something where I can cut from the action into something that is like kind of like Max POV as he's racing through this neighborhood. And I found some footage of someone on a shifter cart who's going by houses in a completely different part of the world, but I think I can make it work. Because what I then want to do is I want to include the thing that's like very near and dear to my heart, which is a instrument cluster that I'll place right here so we can snap in, view a cool like 3D grid, you know, navigational view of the world that Mac is racing through and have some sort of like stupid insight that could pop up and be like, you know, look out, you know, McDonald's Happy Meal ahead or
oh my gosh.
John, I like your mug.
Mm. Thank you. This is only the finest. Hooray. For me.
Mine hasn't arrived yet, but it's on its way.
Oh, you guys.
Mine will be overflowing with shame shortly. So, you know, orbit around my 3D sort of thing here. Maybe I need some sort of like McDonald's icon or beacon that shows up on the map to get me there. While I'm there, might as well make a bunch of random gack really quickly.
I think actually this would be very useful to see because a lot of folks don't know how to make random gack.
So I mean, you can do it any way you please, but for right now, I'm gonna go with some circular forms using stroke. We'll pull some color from some of the stuff that we're doing here. We're going to make this a 3D layer and see if I can just kind of like loosely orient it to the same general perspective that I'm working with.
I hate that it already looks like a super expensive FUI interface. Like,
I know, it does.
Made by Perception. Like, I could see this in the the corner of your website.
Yep. And it's
going to be like, Marvel paid $4 million for that.
It's got the TVA color scheme coming out of it, too. It feels very...
Yeah, we try whenever possible not to just go default blue with...
Which has got to be hard by now.
It's got to be hard just feeling like you're making something new in general each time.
Yeah, I mean, it's funny because we constantly, you know, one of the things that we're always kind of pitching is the idea that, like, well, the technology in your movie shouldn't be anything like the technology in somebody else's movie. But we also made that other movie, so now we need to figure out how to differentiate it further from that. But we've still got, you know, we're still able to find some fun new ways of kind of like rethinking, like, how does imaging tech work in the future in new and unexpected ways?
Yeah, I think the tricky thing too is people generally, just because of everything that's been going on in film for, you know, the last 20-ish years, is that the color of the future is blue. That's the that's the color of the future. So when you want something futuristic, you make it blue. All right, well, I would like to think that the future has more than one color. And perhaps the interfaces will be full color, you know.
How often do you do a wide exploration of different looks only to end up back at, like, we really just want blue crap that glows?
It happens from time to time. But I think we've gotten pretty good at, you know, we even try, like, we're very polite about it, but we do try to make the suggestion that, like, if you make it blue, it's just going to look like everybody else's blue stuff. And, like, sometimes that's a good thing because it means the audience will, like, get it quicker and will understand.
Yeah, it's a good shorthand.
Yeah, exactly. That's the perfect way of putting it. It is a shorthand that is used. And, you know, if the movie is not a movie that, like, wants to, like, really roll around in its own, you know, technology constructs, then it's not that useful to, you know, go super hard on those kinds of things. But when it is, you know, we can get away with some fun opportunities to make some new stuff, some new technology paradigms.
I'm just enjoying watching you gack this up. This is fun.
I mean, I'm doing it the simplest way I can, which is just repeating lots of stuff. And also I'm trying to kind of keep it. It's tricky. I wish this Wave World wireframe would respond to a 3D camera, which it will not. It definitely
part is too bad.
That would be amazing if it would, huh?
Yeah, I'm a little limited there, but I think we can still figure out.
I mean, you could fuss around with expressions and make it do it.
Well, I don't think you can. I don't think it has. There's any other access within Wave World to access where it's rendering it from.
I mean, you can't zoom, you can't, like, move in to it or move away from it, but you can at least spin it around some.
Yeah, I'm rotating it right now to do the default FUI. Like, when something appears, it rotates to enhance, you know, the sense that it's 3D, which is already kind of it falls into that category of tropes that we try to avoid when possible.
I feel like that's kind of showing off, hey, we made this in 3D. Like, we didn't just draw it. Like, when a camera goes real close to a model for no good reason, just because the guy who made it was like, I want you to see how much work I put in these textures, and you can't see it.
Yep.
So we're going to zoom real close to this for no reason.
I do always like that.
I mean, it's hard if you're the person who, like, if you made this like amazing texture and then it's like in the tiny corner of the screen, it's no fun.
It's not.
Tommy S. Universe does not work with the latest version of Premiere Pro. The update that came out during the holiday, like right before the holiday break, that broke Universe has not yet been fixed, but the Universe team is working on it, and the fix with Adobe and the fix should be out shortly. I don't want to give any sort of time frame promises, but it's on our calendar internally, and we have hopes that it will be out soon. It does work in the latest version of After Effects and the beta of After Effects as well. I use it with some frequency in my freelance work. So it does work in After Effects, no problem. And Paul Inman has a question for you, John and Doug. How do the brainstorming sessions work in the early stages for the things that you all create?
That's a great question.
Like, is there like a huge room full of people and you all throw ideas at a board, or is it one person gets given the task and goes off and thinks, or does it change project to project?
In the before times, it was quite literally a bunch of us in a room throwing ideas at a wall. And then we would have a big board where we put up everything that we think is working, and, you know, some things as we're talking might come off the board or move to another part of the board. Like, there was literally, we had a board where we would put stuff onto it. It's a little different now, you know, in our work from home times, but we like to keep sort of the same, I don't know, theory of how we do stuff, with getting people to actually talk to each other and come up with ideas.
Yeah, there's still, like, you know, so the key thing for us, particularly when we're pitching something like a title sequence where it's so like conceptually heavy, is we usually aren't just saying like, well, everyone just start making stuff and then we'll figure it out from there. It's our process is very much like we have to come up with some ideas or almost like written treatments for what this could be. And then, you know, applying also, because like often when we're approaching a title sequence, it's not necessarily locked in stone that we're going to do it. We may be competing against other studios or whatnot for that opportunity. And like, you never know what factor it is that's going to win the pitch or get it signed off on. So we take like a super strategic approach to just making sure that like we have a wide enough range of things that we're exploring and tinkering with. And, you know, for that reason, it's just critical that we're always approaching it from this perspective of like, all right, well, what are the different ideas? How can we make sure that the different ideas that we're coming up with are not just individually cool, but also have some range between each other so that we can play a little bit of this game of like, if we have no idea what they really want, how can we still propose something that'll connect and work for everybody?
Well, that's a tricky thing, because I've done stuff before with directors who don't know what they want. They just keep telling you words, and you're like, well, my interpretation of that word is this, but
that's how you're supposed to do it.
The director's like, I don't want that at all. I'm like, well, these are literally the exact words you said, so I don't know what to tell you, buddy.
That's what directing is, Michael. You have too high expectations for them.
I've definitely worked on things before where they're just like, hey, could you make this feel a little more crunchy? Like,
that's my go-to word. Ooh. Oh, it's this huge sin that I make every time.
But it's really funny. There's in Magic Bullet Looks, there's a filter called pop where someone says, this needs to pop a little bit more. You can literally just apply pop. Or if you have, if you don't have Magic Bullet, Red Giant Universe has a plugin called Finisher that you just crank up some of the little detail slider and it makes the image just feel there more, and it's great for just finishing something off. Like, you know what, it just needs a little bit of just throw finisher on it, crank it up a little bit, and you've got that there.
Crunch. How are we doing, Doug? Did you want us to spin for you again since you basically like finished yours?
I think we should spin for Doug again. We've got 20 minutes he could do something with.
Yeah, give me like 2 minutes and I'll show you how dumb this thing is. And then,
yes,
then we'll be in a good spot. All right. What do I need? I need a little solid here. You know what? Okay. Trying to think now, what am I going to put on top of this to make it better? So I want to see like how many dumb effects I can get into this thing, which is my main goal. And right now I still only have the one dumb effect.
I think a really fun exercise is to take a random effect and limit yourself to, you know, only a few other ancillary effects and just push it around and see what you can come up with it. I know MotionWorks used to do that on a fairly regular basis. They had a little contest that you could use these five effects with this one being the main one and just play with it and see what you can come up with. And people would come up with some amazing stuff with effects that you're like, that I would never have touched that effect. And yet here's this cool thing like CC glue gun or CC hair, right, or, you know, some of these other effects. And you just, you know, some a bit of colorama, a bit of levels and some playing around and, you know, to get away from the default settings. And you can come up with some amazing things. So, hey, you folks out there in viewerland, all of our VFX chillins, do that for yourself. Take one of the CC effects, take an hour, you know, and just play with it. See what you can push it to do.
Unless it's Mr. Smoothie, in which case you will be very bored and have nothing to do. I am disappointed. I've not been able to come up with anything to do with this.
I've gone beyond trying to make something look good, and I'm well into the world of like, I'm just going to make something real dumb.
One of our most popular episodes was our meme episode where we just made a bunch of really dumb things with the Zuck.
He says that as if, Hashi, we don't make dumb things every week.
I appreciate that you did that, Michael.
That looks pretty rad, Hashi.
I've got some stuff going on.
Did you add smoke and atmosphere, Hashi?
I've added maybe a little bit of smoke and atmosphere. I'm trying right now. What I'm trying to do is I'm trying to add a procedural bit of depth to the this monstrosity. So when it opens up, it doesn't look as thin because it's just a shell.
Oh,
but I'm trying to like.
So You're doing that trick. Are you doing the trick from the Droon tutorial?
Pretty much the trick from the Droon tutorial. If I were doing this for real, I would use Universe Point Zoom, because that effect I could do this with. Let's see. Point Zoom basically is like a holograph, like projector effect. So whatever your image is, you now get a control point from where it's being projected, like this. So if you have an object like this, these jaws, look at this. The extrusion of them looks kind of 3D.
Oh, that's cool.
And like you could probably turn the length down to not be so long, and then you'd get just a little extrusion like that.
And then you could play with it. What effect is that?
It's called point zoom, universe point zoom.
Yeah, it's like a reverse shine.
It works really great for making holographic projectors, but you can cheat it and stuff like this to add some depth to a round thing.
Rumor is that it exists, and Harry might be listening and tell me I'm totally wrong. Jace might be listening and tell me I'm wrong. I believe Jace Hansen told Harry Frank at one point, like what we while working on Force Awakens, was like, what we really need is a reverse trap code shine that can basically emanate like rays, but from a specific point. And so Harry went and made point zoom.
So we did something like that on Endgame. We have all this kind of like light projector look the first part of it. And what that is we kind of made a fake reverse shine where we put lights in the scene of where we wanted the light to project to. So if it was supposed to come from behind us, we put the light kind of in front and made that the focal point of the shine, so that the shine was going the other direction, and it started to look like projector beams.
Nice.
Which was our cheat for getting a quick and easy kind of film projector look.
But now there's two good effects in universe. There's the point zoom, which Hashi's using, and then there's quantum, which works great on text to give you real shiny, like projected glowy that sort of
stuff
look.
I don't know why I didn't think of this, but with CC sphere, so I have this one comp with CC sphere like this, and then I opened up the essential graphics window and I dragged all of the properties from down here that I wanted to up here, like the which part of the sphere to render, what the light intensity was and light direction and light color. And the reason I did that is because now when I put that sphere over in this other comp, if I twirl it open, you can see that all of those properties are now controllable. So I can tell it to render the outside of the sphere up here. I can put an inside of the sphere down here, and they're all still sourcing this one here where I have the animation and rotation. I don't have to make sure that I'm keeping identical copies. They're all sort of the same. So if I render just outside...
So if you change the animation speed or the rotation speed in that one comp, it's reflected in all those other ones, but they all have unique properties that you have changed.
Exactly. So I just realized that if I make a duplicate... as you can see, this is a render of just the outside of the sphere. And then down here at the bottom, I have a render of the inside of the sphere. And for that, I turned the light intensity up a bit. But I'm also making another duplicate of this and just scaling it down like 1%. So it doesn't quite connect. But the illusion is that it has a little bit of edge on the teeth there.
That's a neat way to do it. Seth, is there a reason Hashi's screen is coming across on the stream significantly blurrier than yours?
There's not that I know of, except maybe if I click grid view, it might bring it back to be... Mainly because he's coming over Skype and I'm not. It might fix in a second. Let's see.
Because he's sharp. I mean, he's sharp in Skype to me, but he is blurrier than yours on the stream.
Well, Michael...
I was just curious...
I can't think of a snarky thing to say. It's one of those things.
It's actually, I should say, I'm not the one that was curious about it, but Joel Petrell in the chat is being a real baby about it.
Oh, wow.
Hey, Joel.
Just kidding, Joel.
He's not kidding, Joel.
I mean, he does have the sarcastic .. at the end of his comment.
Oh, well then.
Yeah. So I'm taking that as extremely dripping with sarcasm. Each dot is a drip of sarcasm. Mm.
Every dot a drip, as they say. And
hey, what's your guys' saving protocols like?
Do when it.
60 seconds. Every 60 seconds.
Oh yeah, I should probably save this project.
That's then mine. What Doug just said is my
minutes,
protocol.
I do the claw to get an increment and save, so I have incrementally saved versions.
Mm-hmm. I always set my auto save to 2 minutes with 5 versions and. Increment usually like crazy. All right, let's see. I've lost my lighting on the inside of the sphere, but if I twirl down here, I can just go to the essential properties and turn up the light intensity a bit. Right now it's white light. I can change that to being more of a red. Red light always mixes so bizarrely.
But it looks so cool.
It looks cool when you can get it right, but it's like really, really tricky.
Like you can't turn up...
It just be solid red, yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Like you can't.
Well, the problem is solid red mixing with solid red is just gonna be. It's just gonna be red. You have to mix other colors into there to make it just slightly off red. I mean, it's true for red, green, and blue. You have to have some other color values in there, or it'll just go the solid of that color, which is no good. It applies to 3D renders too. So if you're using like Octane Redshift or Cinema 4D's built-in physical renderer and you've got a lot of light hitting something, if it's solid red, it's not going to blow out like it should when you hit a bunch of light on it because it's just bouncing back the red and nothing else. So you have to mix in some other color to get it to actually react correctly to your lighting. So this is a good tip for glowing in After Effects and for rendering 3D stuff.
Yeah, the other tricky thing with the red is that...
Oh, now Joel Petrell's got some sarcastic exclamation points in the chat. Listen, Joel.
So the other tricky thing about red is that it can end up looking really pink or kind of pale sometimes when you want to make something look nice and glowy. It's always it's a tricky one.
Yeah, I always end up pushing it towards yellow with a little bit of green or towards purple with a little bit of blue. You have to go one way or the other. And to me, orange reads more red than purple does.
Right. And always like a little, like a tiny little bit of green in there.
Oh, I just forgot. We had a question way back in the chat, and I forgot to pass on to you. Is Perception hiring? Rabbit Studios wants to know.
Yes, always. Yes.
Please, yeah. I want reels, resumes, portfolios. I want to talk to every single motion graphics artist that is in this space, because we're always looking for help. We're always looking for assistance, freelance, full-time, junior, senior, in between, all of it. We're, you know, we're always excited to meet new talent. So please shower us with reels.
You know what? I should probably send you my new one whenever I get around to doing it. I'm a very big particle person and very big.
Are you trying to get hired off of our show, Michael?
I was just thinking I could do some particle work if they need particle work done. Only if you like someone who enjoys working nights and weekends though.
Oh man,
one of our
I got a full time job right here. And I'm not
one of, yeah, one of our requirements.
They gave me socks with my face on them, so I'm not giving that up.
Yeah, you can't turn that away.
Your workstation needs to stay on the same plot of land for a continuous period of time. That's one of our requirements. I'm sorry, Michael.
Darn out of luck.
Such an arbitrary rule to make just to alienate Michael.
Gabriel Stern from the chat says, me and some other students just started a motion design studio for our last year of undergrad. Is there a way we could reach out after the stream to score us major brownie points with our prof?
Sure. Brownie points, just, yeah.
Wait, what? What are they asking?
I don't know, but I'm going to say yes.
Why? No. it's always no, I mean, smart. That's
just, isn't that what you're supposed to do? Just say yes to everything.
Everything, yes. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
To where would you like resumes and reels sent? The Rabbit Studios and others in the chat are interested.
You can send them straight to, I believe it's, if you go on the website, we've got an address specifically for that stuff. I forget what the exact email is. I should know that before making giant pronouncements like this. But
I say you don't want someone who's not willing to do a little bit of legwork to find.
Yeah, do a little digging.
Do the minimal amount of digging, and you'll find the address specifically for, you know, job inquiries on our website. I believe we currently have, like, you know, job postings on Motionographer and maybe some other places as well. And you can sniff around and find, particularly Doug and I, on social media and all that stuff to track us down.
Hey, folks, we've got about 5 minutes left in our scheduled time for today's show. So if you've got questions that you would like to ask Doug and John now, it would be a good time to put them in the chat, and I will pass that on to them. And all right, to you folks, Doug, Daniel, Hashi, and Seth.
Oh, my goodness. How did we get here already? Yeah. This is crazy.
Nope.
You might want to start putting your stuff together so we can you can show off your goodness.
Show off.
All right. I got my RAM preview going.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, I'm sharing my screen. I don't know if anyone can.
I'm over. Boom.
Boom. There we go.
Yes.
This is my.
It tells a story.
He's going back home.
Oh, it's so perfect.
Wow.
Oh, that is beautiful.
Listen, I told you, if I can't make something good, I'm going to make something stupid. So
you did it. You did it.
That's so funny. So great. I love that.
I think my only real note is I could tighten up those keys a little bit. Yeah, I think those keyframes get a little tightened up, but otherwise, I'm ready to ship it.
It's perfect.
It's perfect. I agree. Oh my gosh. I love that you guys took time out of your real jobs to come on our show and do this.
If there's an experienced house that you would like to slow down for an afternoon, yeah, recommend them to VFX and chill.
I actually really enjoy doing this. We're so busy right now with work that, you know, coming out and humiliating ourselves in front of the entire internet is actually genuinely relaxing at this moment.
That's so sweet. That's good to hear.
We're glad that we can be your stress release.
Absolutely.
There you go. Make him look even better.
Oh, yeah.
Let's see what happens here. Oh boy. This is the thing. So if anyone was worried that they weren't good enough, I'm a professional.
No, I think it's great. Like, you took an effect and made something cool with it. That's fun.
I think cool is being wildly generous, and I appreciate that. What does this need? It probably needs a lens flare.
Lens flares are always good.
Yeah, so let's throw in...
I think it needs some sort of puff at the moment of disconnection.
Yeah, well. It needs like a little thing.
A little thing, yeah.
Yeah. Let's throw in our lens flare. And, you know, we got to keep it classy, so it's just out of frame.
Just out of frame.
Classy is a word we're using today.
Put it just out of frame over there. Let's see, what am I doing over here? And then go there. Can I just move that down a little bit? Guys, I'm ready for this. I'm excited. There we go.
Oh, it's marvelous.
You did it.
Just, I mean, you came from, this thing spins a layer around its center to that is, I think you're being way too humble about how cool that is.
This is going on my reel.
When I got go that far.
Fine.
No, I think you should. I think fun stuff like that in reels is nice. I hire people. I would hire you.
I would.
Congratulations, guys! You have a job.
Yeah, where can I send my
Michael? Would hire you.
Where can I send my resume?
1:59. We have to stop.
John, what you got? Let's see what John has. I want to see what John has.
Okay. I got something coming together. Hold on. I got RAM preview.
Is RAM preview in?
Hashi, Seth, you better get yours ready too.
Oh, I have nothing. Fine. This is literally all I came up with. This, whatever the hell this is. Mr. Smoothie, I am excited to see someone do something with Mr. Smoothie, but I could not get anything I thought would work to work. So we ended
folks
up
folks in the chat and watching on this live stream now or over the next week. Send us on Twitter and Instagram and tag Red Giant News and let us know if you do something cool with CC Smoothie.
Yeah.
And play with it this week and tag us in it.
We would genuinely love to see that.
Yes, I
love seeing anything that you all make out there.
And don't forget to hashtag VFX and chill. It's spelled VFX and chill.
Let's see, what is this? I just threw on Mr. Smoothie just to kind of see. And yeah, I don't know what that's doing. Well, it's kind of an interesting background thing it's doing there. Let's see.
John, I'm looking at yours.
All right. It's my machine's about to explode trying to handle all of this and Skype at the same time, but I think we're there.
I'm on board with that heads up display thing you've got going on there. Did you use point zoom to make that projection?
I didn't use point zoom. I'm angry that I heard today for the first time.
That's a problem with Universe is it's so full of tools. Sometimes you miss out on the one that's perfect for what you need to do.
So we've got Mac being chased by dogs. Important alert.
Next left. Oh, my God.
Well, that is not playing down smooth. At least not for me anyway. But
no,
you know what? I'm looking at the Skype thing. I don't see the...
I mean, I'm getting like chromatic and like graphics card meltdown on all of the video feeds right now, so I'm not terribly surprised that it's not playing smoothly. My poor
well,
I should
what?
Have probably
this
rendered
is, this
out.
Right here is going to be our new technical difficulties sign right here. This will be our screen that comes up when we have technical difficulties.
I love it.
That would be a good technical difficulty screen. John, can you send Hashi and or Seth your finished renders after this so we can put a little reel together of what we came up with?
Yes. This is one of those things where I'd really like time to make this look better.
But you can take
I'm sure Perception would love I take more time out of my day to perfect this thing.
Hashi, are you done with yours? I want to see yours.
Sure.
In full motion, if your computer could go.
All right, let me get this. I'll try to make it a little bit bigger here, and let's see. Let it load up here.
I mean, that's...
I tried to quickly add a second level of Jaws because I remember the Jaws was the assignment, so...
I'd say you've succeeded at Jaws.
And here we go. It's I don't know.
And that's pretty cool.
I know it is. Darth Vader hyperbaric chamber thing. Yeah. That was, Nick Smith suggested that? Yes. Thank you. I owe this all to him. I had no earlier direction before this.
I think it's pretty great. I'm all for it.
Well, I have enjoyed this episode immensely.
We did silly
things. We did great things. We watched Hawkeye titles and talked about them, which fantastic title sequence. Excellent job. Yeah. Again, very different.
I can't believe we started
the WandaVision
there.
Titles.
I can't believe that we started with the Hawkeye titles and then got to this somehow. But that's the magic of VFX and chill and the magic of Perception. You guys, I can't believe you freaking keep coming on our show. You guys are the best people in the world.
Thank you. Anytime you want. We'll be back next week.
I mean, you have the link. You can do it. Anything you guys want to plug or direct people to before we jump off?
Yeah, I mean, just keep tabs on Perception. We've got a lot of really cool stuff that's currently in progress or nearing completion that will be starting to kind of sprinkle out through 2022. And, you know, like we said, anybody that's interested in, reaching out about opportunities, we're always in need of extra help. If you know anybody, like, we're so weirdly specialized in what we do. We've got such a bizarrely specific niche. If you know anybody that you think fits into our weird little world, tell them to get in touch and reach out, because we always need an extra hand.
Very cool. Hashi, you got anything? Or Doug, you got anything? And then Hashi, you got anything?
Just gonna kind of say what Johnny said is, send us reels, send us people. You know, we're always looking for more.
Awesome.
Yeah,
awesome.
And if you are on the socials, please follow everyone here on this screen. Send stuff to us, and if you use that hashtag VFX and chill, we'll probably see your comment or a suggestion for our shows. The fourth Friday of every month, we're going to do one of our VFX Royale battles, so send in characters for that. It looks like we'll have to add Mac from Mac and Me to that list.
Definitely.
Mm-hmm. Oversight for sure, but it's been so fun to have you fellas.
Yeah, unbelievably fun. Thank you, guys.
Thank you. Thank you. This is a ton of fun.
With that, I think we're going to credits. Yeah, that's right. I forgot what we were doing. Hey, you guys rule. Thank you so much. Have a great week. We'll see everybody back here next week. I think they can hear us, so we shouldn't talk.